Obviously, it's absolutely traumatic. And in some ways, as the hours pass, it actually gets much worse and not better, because the fact of it actually having been real sinks in. To lose a father to COVID, whose last words to his daughter were, "I'm choking, please give me treatment." I think it just haunts me. Is there something else I could have done? Could I have done it differently? Even when we cremated him, even when we finally said goodbye, there was a fight at the cremation ground because there were more bodies than there was space. And eventually, the police had to be called in to organize what was happening. It's an extremely traumatizing time for me personally. But the reason I do think I still have to find the courage to speak is because, as a journalist, I've been so often on the other side, speaking to families who've gone through what I have gone through. But also, James, because what I have gone through, crushing as it is to me personally, does not even begin to describe what most Indians are going through. My father could not live, but he got the best medical attention. He got the best private hospital, and it was still traumatic. I still had to fight for everything. But crushed as I am, what's happening to thousands and thousands of Indians is much worse.
How is it working? Is it literally that you need either money or you need to know somebody to get someone who's very ill into intensive care?
Frankly, even money or knowing someone isn't really going to help much right now. What's happened is that the hospital system is completely overrun. And even when they have beds, without an oxygenated bed, a bed is useless for a serious COVID patient. Doctors are doing their best, health workers are doing their best, but they just do not have the infrastructural support that they need to save lives. I have met with families who have spent 12 hours on the road going in an ambulance from hospital to hospital and finally just giving up and going back home, sometimes losing their relatives on the street.
This is very important because we had a representative from the government, spokesman for the BJP, on the programme yesterday, who denied outright that people were dying on the street.
That's absolutely not true. What I mean is that there are people who leave their home to go to a hospital in whatever mode of transport that they can manage. It can be an ambulance if they can organize one. It can be an auto rickshaw. It can be sometimes at the back of a motorcycle. And the hospital won't take them in. And there have been deaths. I have personally chronicled the accounts of families where the death has taken place en route to finding a hospital. I have spoken to the families of these people, myself, personally.
Tell us about the crematorium. You mentioned the difficulties in finding space there. What does that tell you about the numbers and the official reporting of deaths?
After having travelled to at least four different states, the cremation grounds are the only barometer of the gap between the official data and the number of people who are actually dying on the ground. So when I walk into a cremation ground and an undertaker at a single site, let's say in Surat in Gujarat, which is a western state, when the undertakers at these single sites tell me, today we cremated 100 bodies, today we cremated 130 bodies, and the official data for the entire state is less than what I'm finding at one site, we know now that our casualty figures are not reflecting the actual deaths that are taking place. We need urgent death audits, because the very least I think that our people deserve is for at least our dead to be counted. The last crematorium I was at, where I cremated my father, I met the brother of someone whose body was lying on the floor. And he said to me, I could neither give him dignity in life because he couldn't get a hospital for him, nor can I give him dignity in death. And there's enormous pressure on Indian journalists to stop telling stories from cremation grounds.
The failure to prepare for this second wave, the government told us it was a sudden tsunami. No one could have seen it coming, and that they're doing their very best under impossible circumstances. What would you say to that?
I would say that there's finally some urgency in government response, but it was not the urgency that we needed, expected, and wanted at least a month and a half ago. And that critical loss of 6 weeks has cost untold lives. So I'd list the failures as the following. Let's say the government genuinely believed that the first wave had been fought successfully. In 2020, this country had set up giant, jumbo, makeshift field hospital kind of facilities. They were all dismantled. What was the need to dismantle hospitals? For some reason, India calculated that the worst of COVID was behind it. We even gifted away and exported vaccines to smaller countries, as you know. Our vaccine rollout program was extremely late. We lost two critical months in giving approvals to foreign-made vaccines. in my father's case, I keep thinking he'd had one jab. If he'd had a second jab, maybe he'd have, you know, he would have had a better chance at being alive today. Why did we underorder vaccines? Why have election rallies? The most egregious thing that I have seen as a journalist, mammoth political rallies carried on. Even till 2 days ago, there were election rallies taking place for different elections in India. How can you tell the citizens of this country to follow COVID-appropriate behavior when from the top down, these election rallies and these religious congregations were allowed to take place? And finally, how can our health minister, when our death rate, the official death rate, which by the way, I don't believe, was above 3,600 deaths, the health minister makes a tone-deaf statement saying, India is much better equipped to fight COVID than it was in 2020. So there's a kind of...
Is it hubris?
It's hubris. Yeah. It's denial. It's insensitivity. It's mistakes. It's bureaucracy. And there is that arrogance, maybe, that there'll be no political prize. And as long as politicians believe that, they don't seem to change how they respond.
Just one final question, Barkha. Perhaps you could just tell us how you'll remember your father.
Oh, thank you for asking me that, because I've tried very hard to erase the image I have of him on a ventilator. But my father was a man of science. He believed in tinkering with machines. He would sometimes break little radio sets just to repair them. He was consumed by science and he followed every scientific development on COVID. He was a feminist father. He set my sister and I free to follow our own paths and our passions. He was kind and compassionate and handsome and ever smiling. And I've never met anyone who had a bad word to say about him. And I know he'd be appalled to see his country doing some really strange things like abandon scientific temperament, continue to privilege politics and religion over the saving of human lives. And that is why all I can do today is to somehow find the courage to keep telling this story, if not for anyone else's sake, but for what he would have wanted me to do.